the grid, break into the wild, and don't be afraid. Run into wide open spaces, grace is waiting for you. Dance like the weight has been lifted, grace is waiting. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom, there is freedom. Come out of the dark, just as you are, into the fullness of His love. Oh, the Spirit is here, let there be freedom, let there be freedom.
It says, chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name. So y'all, let's declare this over our morning.
Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Lives made whole, hearts awake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Sing it out.
Chains will fall, prisons shake at the sound of Jesus' name.
Yeah.
fast, my soul. He's in the waiting. He's in the waiting. And hold on to your hope as your triumph unfolds. He's never failing. He's never failing. My soul finds strength in joy. Let his words lead you on. Do not forget his great faithfulness. He'll finish all he's begun. So take courage, my heart. Stay steadfast, my soul. He's in the waiting. He's in the waiting. Hold on to your hope as your triumph unfolds. He's never fading. He's never fading. Take courage, my heart. Stay steadfast, my soul. He's in the waiting. In the waiting, and hold on to as your triumph unfolds. He's never failing. He's never failing. And you heard the stars, who call them each by name. You'll surely keep your promise to me that I will rise in your victory. Sing you hold, and you hold the stars, yes, who call them each by name.
He's never failing. We can rejoice just in that simple truth right there, church, that he's never failing. Wow, so good, so good. Well, I'm glad you guys are here. And the Father's here. If you couldn't tell already, he's here, right here with us. Thank you, Jesus. Colossians And I'll be honest, this is a completely different scripture than we read Thursday night. And sometimes that's just the way he works. It's just, he told me this morning, I don't want you to read that again. Okay. Yes, sir. So this is it. Colossians 1, starting in verse 11. May you be filled with joy, always thanking the Father. He has enabled you to share in the inheritance that belongs to his people who live in the light. For he has rescued us from the kingdom of darkness and transferred us into the kingdom of his dear Son, who purchased our freedom and forgave our sins. Amen. Amen. Pray with me, church. Father, we're so thankful. So thankful. You purchased our freedom and forgave our sins. Despite the dirty people we are, you want us and you love us, no matter where we are in life. All the same, your goodness is beyond our understanding. Thank you that you want to spend time with us. And Father, in this moment, as a body, we declare your goodness. We sing praises to you. Every clap, every hand raised, every shout, every dance, every chord, every lyric, it's all for you. We are here for you and because of you. So you do what only you can do in this place. Father, we love you so much. And we're so thankful that you came to us. We praise you, Father, in your name. Amen.
Oh, holy night, the stars are brightly shining. Sin and ever pride till he appeared and the soul felt it all. I feel of the weary world rejoices for yonder. For the slave is our brother. name, all oppression shall cease.
Sweet hymn.
Sweet hymns of joy in grateful chorus praise we let all within us praise his holy name. Christ is the Lord. Oh, praise his name forever. His
divine moment, just like right now. You are here in this place. Continue to move. Continue to do what only you can do. We love you. Amen. Amen. You guys can take a seat.
Well, good morning, Rock Church. How's everybody doing? Good? This is Christmas weekend, so I want you to do me a favor because I know we got a bunch of people watching online and at our C3 coffee bar just across the parking lot. So do me a favor. I want you to wish all of them a Merry Christmas as loud as you can at the count of three. Here we go. One, two, three. Merry Christmas! So thankful for you guys. Thankful for everybody watching online. And maybe you're here today. You're a guest with us. Maybe it's your first time ever or first time in a long time. Man, thanks for being here. My name's Josh. I'm one of the pastors. And just so thankful for our church, and that we get to do this. You know what I mean? And I'm thankful that you've made a decision that this weekend that you're going to make the Rock part of your Christmas experience, that you're going to have this Christmas experience over the next couple days, and you've said, I want to start by going to church and spending some time. And I hope while you're here that, one, that you've had a great experience so far. I hope we get to laugh a little bit together. I hope we get to worship together as we have, but then we'll continue to do so. But I also hope if you're new with us that you just have felt it and you've recognized it, that this is a place where people are loved and God is loved. That we really just have a vision here as a church, a mission as a church to love God and love people because God matters and people matter, all right? Church, would you agree with that? So if you are new with us, I hope that's what you experience, all right? And we're in this series called Waiting on Christmas, and we've been talking about it for the last month, really, last 4 weekends. Now, it doesn't conclude today. It actually will conclude on Tuesday, Christmas Eve. So I definitely want to invite you back for kind of the conclusion of this series. You got invites. Make sure you take them with you. Don't leave any on the chairs, and invite somebody to come back with you on Tuesday when we wrap up the message. But what we've said so far is we've went with what is called an Advent ring, all right? And I know Advent is maybe new to some of you guys. What the Advent means, it simply means waiting, all right? So the whole idea of waiting on Christmas, that's where Advent comes from. It's this idea of waiting on someone or something of importance. And the idea of Advent ring came about back hundreds of years ago, where people, Christians, started celebrating the weeks leading up to Christmas. And what Christians would do is they would light a candle on the weeks, each week leading up to Christmas. And the first candle would represent the idea of joy. And we talked about that 3 weeks ago. We talked about how you can find joy in Christ. And then 2 weeks ago, we talked about the idea of love, about at the Christmas season, we find love. And then last week, we talked about peace. And we talked about the idea that during this time of year, or not really just this time of year, but at all times, you can find peace with God and the peace of God in Christ. And that's something that we should all long to have. Well, today we're going to talk about one more characteristic of Christ, and that's this characteristic of hope. Now, I want you to think about hope for a second, because hope is a word we use often. It's almost like we interchange it with the word wish, all right? And there's a big difference between wish and hope. I had a wish that the Patriots wouldn't make it in to the playoffs this year. And as you know, a wish means something that is improbable, that you're maybe thinking might happen, but you know it's really like zero chance, right? And that's the reason that's a wish, all right? Hope is the opposite of that. Hope is something that is probable. Hope is an anticipation of an expectation. That I'm hoping for something means that I'm expecting something to happen. So with that in mind, let me ask you this. What are you hoping for this Christmas? Like some of you in here are hoping for a Clemson victory next weekend, okay? That's what some of you are hoping for. Gamecock fans are wishing that they'll lose, okay? You know what I mean? It's like, we just don't know, all right? Here's another one. I am hoping that this final Star Wars will be better than the last one. Anybody with me? Has anybody seen Star Wars yet? The new, okay, all right. I figure that, don't, no spoiler alerts, okay? I'm not going till Christmas. But my hope is that this last Star Wars, that it'll finish well, because it's wrapping up a whole saga that began when I was a child, right? Star Wars has been going on for 5 decades. Ooh. Yeah, some of you are like me, you're like, yeah, I remember when they came out, right? But so my hope is that it will finish well, that the storylines will all be wrapped up and it'll finish clean, and you'll be like, yes, like I hope it finishes much better than the Game of Thrones finished, okay? That's one of my hopes, right? But let's talk about it even more from a Christmas perspective. Sometimes we have this idea of hope, and it's this idea that I hope that they like the presents. That when my kid comes running downstairs and he immediately goes for the biggest present, because that's what you do as kids, right? That's what you do. You run down the stairs, you run through the hall, you get to the Christmas tree, and you grab the biggest one because you're hoping that it is the present that you've been hoping for. Like, you're expecting it to be the present that you hope for. And as soon as you, as a kid, pick up that big present, what does your mom say? Put it down. You got to start with the littler one, right? And the kid will open up the little one going, well, no, that's not what I was hoping for. Can I open this one now? And when that child opens that present they've been hoping for, it like changes their life, right? Until the batteries run out, or until they break it, or until grandma buys something bigger, okay? But we think, we expect that present will be everything I hope for. You know, the same is true of all of us teenagers, adults, that we do the same thing in life. It's not just with Christmas. See, at Christmas, we think that the present is everything I hope for. But in reality, what we do in life is we try to find things in life that will give us everything that we hope for. That we'll pick up things going, well, I'm going to pick up this because I think this will give me the life that I've been hoping for, meaning the life I've been expecting and anticipating. And we'll pick it up thinking that'll do the job. Well, what is it that we pick up? See, sometimes we'll pick up, let's just call this one wealth. That we'll think, well, if I pick up wealth, then wealth will give me the life that I've been hoping for. That as long as I pursue wealth and pursue riches and pursue stuff, that if I get enough stuff, then that's going to give me the life that I've hoped for. But unfortunately, many times it's just like a Christmas present, and it's good for a while, but it doesn't satisfy over the long run. So then we're like, well, that's not enough. So I'll pick up something else. And maybe I'll pick this up, and this will give me the life I hope for. And maybe I'll pick up health, right? That I pick up wealth, and now I'm picking up health because I'm like, well, if I just make my body look good and go to the gym and do all those things, right? Well, let me give you a little secret for all of you younger. You can put on all that muscle, but gravity eventually will win. It's gonna happen, okay? And we'll think, well, that will satisfy, that this will give me the life I'm hoping for. And then you go, nope, that didn't give me the life I'm hoping for. So well, let me pick up something else. And I'll be like, well, I'll just pick up love. Yeah, I'll pick up love because love will satisfy, and love will give me the life that I've been hoping for. So then I'll start pursuing relationships, and I'll think that'll do it. And I've got money, I've got my health, I've got love now, and I'll start doing things for love, and then I still feel like, well, no, that still didn't give me the life I was expecting. And then I'll No, not that one. I want that one. I want the big one. No, I want the big one because these aren't working. I need to, thank you. So I'll pick that up thinking that this will work. And maybe, what is this? Well, this is success. That if I pick up success, that success. You see what's going on? Is we keep picking these things up. And we think, well, that will work. And then it doesn't work. And I get all convoluted. I'm like, no, I got to get all my stuff together. Because if I pick up all of it, then maybe eventually it'll give me the life I'm hoping for. And success and popularity and money and health and love, happiness, none of them will fully fulfill. Oh, they might help for a short season. But they're not going to give you the life that you're hoping for over the long run. So my question to you today, very specific question, is what will it take for you to drop everything. What will it take for you to drop everything to pick up something else? And what it would take is the confidence that this is better than all those. And what I am wanting to tell you today with confidence is that the life that you're hoping for is attainable. The life that you're hoping for can be found. And that you can live the rest of your life, whether you're in here as a teenager or whether you're a senior citizen, that you can live for the rest of your life with the life that you hoped for. And the place that you find that life is inside of the Christmas story. Because inside of the Christmas story, what we'll find is the source of hope, the promise of hope, and the thrill of hope. So that's what I want us to hit. Is I want you to be able to walk out of here today with confidence that you've actually not only found, but you've picked up the one thing that can actually give you the life you're hoping for, and that is Jesus Christ. And the way that happens is it starts by going to the source of hope. That if you want the life you've hoped for, you got to go to the source of hope. And the source of hope is God. We're going to look at a verse from Romans chapter 15, 13. It's not a Christmas verse, but as you read into this verse, you will see the whole Christmas story being played out. The whole story of Christ. It starts with this. It says, I pray that God, the source of hope, that God is the one who can bring you hope, that wealth, that love, that success, the happiness, that can't do it. But God can. And we see that by just looking at some of the stories, some of the characters in the Christmas story. That if you think about it, think about the wise men for a second. Maybe you've heard about them. You've seen them in a nativity scene. Some people call them the magi. Some people call them kings. We don't know a lot about them, but what we do know is that they were wealthy, that they were like scientists, that they studied the stars. And as they were studying the stars, all of a sudden a new star showed itself in the sky. And as this new star was shining, they said, hey, remember the prophecies? That somehow they knew about a prophecy from the book of Numbers, all right? Might have been during the Babylonian captivity that they got connected with some Jewish people and heard the prophecy. We don't really know because these are not Jewish people. They're from afar, okay? But they hear the prophecy, they see a star, and they're like, maybe that's the prophecy is being fulfilled. Because remember it says that a star will rise, a star will appear, and when that star appears, it means that a king has been born in Jerusalem. Well, let's go find this king. So these magi, these wise men, they go on this long journey. They find themselves in Jerusalem. They go to the palace because that's where you would find a king, right? And when they get there, they say, Herod, can you tell us where the new king is? We've seen his star shine in the sky. It just showed up. So we've come here to worship. And Herod freaks out about this because Herod's like, I ain't no new king in my family line. So he wants to know what's going on, and they go back, and they kind of study history, and they realize, yep, that's true. And then next thing you know, the kings leave from there. They see the star shining over Bethlehem, so they go to Bethlehem. The star stops right on top of a house, and they walk in, and they find Jesus. And when they find Jesus, they bow down, and they worship, and they give up gifts of frankincense and myrrh. They give lavish gifts to Jesus. And then they worship him for a while, then they leave. That they, these wise men, they found the source of hope. That the star wasn't their hope. The star was a sign that hope had arrived, and they followed the star until they found the Christ. And then they worshiped. Well, we could talk about other people in the Christmas story, though. We could talk about the shepherds. There were some shepherds out in the field, and one day, all of a sudden, an angel shows up. And when the angel shows up, it says, listen, I bring you good news of great joy for all people. A Savior has been born today, and he's in Bethlehem. Go and see. So they go, and they see a baby sitting in a manger, and they worship. We could talk about Anna and Simeon. They were two older people hanging out in the temple, and one day Jesus showed up. And when Jesus showed up, they said, "There he is. Here is the Messiah, the one that we've been waiting for our entire life. He's now here." The source of their joy was right in front of them. Or you could talk about Mary and Joseph. Mary and Joseph, who had gone through a very tragic time, a time of trials, yet in the midst of it, they found peace because they understood the source of hope. And that source of hope was Jesus. That all through the Christmas story, we see the source of hope. But let me take a time out for a second, because I know I'm saying this, and for all of you who have faith in Christ, you're like, yep, amen, I'm there. But I know some of you that you struggle with that, because you're like, well, isn't that just a good story? Isn't it just a story that's been passed on year after year after year? Well, I want to say, well, let's go further with it then. Because if it was just about God becoming man, think about that statement, just about God becoming man. That's a big deal. That's a big deal. Because that's really what it is their source of hope is found in the fact that God became a man. But again, you might say, well, but I don't know if I believe that. Well, that's where I want you to continue the story. Because the Christmas story isn't just about a baby in a manger. The Christmas story is about God becoming a man as a baby and then growing up through his teen years into his young adult years, and as a young adult making a decision that he's going to follow the Lord and do everything that God has told him to do, everything the Father told him to do. And he started living in such a way that he started doing ministry. And he started letting people know that he was the Messiah. And he started asking people to follow him. And this ragtag group of guys, people like Peter and James and John, they started following him. And as they're following him, they see something in him that is totally different. We're saying, man, there is a source here that we've never experienced before. That he's got something that we've never seen, that we've never had. He's doing miracles. He's raising the dead. And they go, man, we got to follow this guy. We have found the source of our hope, the coming Messiah. It's like, yes. And then all of a sudden he goes, guys, I don't need to let you know I'm going to die. Now make sure you catch that part of the story. And he says, but I'm going to die. Like, I know you're loving this and you're thinking I'm the source of hope, and I am, but for me to truly be your source of hope, I also have to die. And they're like, no, we don't want you to die. But he dies. And he doesn't just die. He predicts his death. He predicts his crucifixion. He predicts his resurrection. After he died, he was buried in a tomb for 3 days, and then he rose from the dead. And when he rose from the dead, he showed himself to those disciples. And then he showed himself to a group, hundreds of people. And that group then understood, wow, now he's truly our source of hope. Because it's not just God becoming man and dying on our behalf, but it is God rising from the dead to give us the power of the resurrection. See, hope in a manger is one thing, but hope in a manger and in a cross and in a resurrection, that's a whole nother thing. And that's what the disciples came to understand. So much so that every one of them was willing to die for that cause. Because they came to understand the source of hope. And in Christ, they found the life that they were hoping for. See, that's the next part of it. It says this, that I pray that God, the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust in him. That when you understand that Jesus is the source of hope, then he can give you great joy and great peace. It's why we talk about these things. He'll give us great joy and he'll give us great peace. That joy is overflowing. That joy never ends. Even in the midst of trials and hardships, I will rejoice. The writer of this book, Romans, the guy's name's Paul, he rejoiced in the midst of a jail cell because he had Christ in his life. He found peace in the midst of a jail cell because he had peace with God and the peace of God all around him. You can find the hope that you're looking for, and you can find that joy and that peace, and it can completely fill you when you trust in him. See, here's something I need to make sure we catch, is that he is the source of hope. But as the source of hope, he wants to give you joy and he wants to give you peace. But he gives that to you when you trust. See, you actually have to be willing to drop those other things and say, that's not where I'll find my hope. But what I'll find my hope is in the life that Christ offers. And for me to take that, then I have to trust him enough to receive that life. And my challenge today is, if you haven't trusted him yet, that today is the day. That today is the day that you'll make a decision in your life and you'll say, I'm ready to trust him as my Savior. Because when you trust him, then you get the next thing. And the next thing is the thrill of hope. Look at the next part of the verse. Then you will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. That I will have confidence in the hope that is right before me. And with the confidence of hope, I will have through the power of the Holy Spirit. When I have the confidence of hope that comes through the power of the Holy Spirit, then I will experience the thrill of hope. Because here's what I want to make sure that we all understand. That when you trust in Christ as your source of hope, he will take you on the ride of your life. The ride of your life. Anybody else with me on that one? The ride of your life. That if you think Christianity is boring, if you think faith is boring, if you think accepting Christ in your life is going to make you live a slowed down, boring type life, then you have heard or bought in to the type of Christianity that Jesus doesn't offer. Because what Jesus offers is the ride of your life, because you get the power of the Holy Spirit. That everything that Jesus did, he wants to continue to do through us. And that's what he said to the disciples. And that's the reason the disciples said, yes, you are my source of hope. Because I have understood the promise of hope. And through that, they went on the thrill of hope. And these guys like Peter and John and James, they walked on water. They raised the dead. That they saved people's lives. That they went out and preached the gospel and saw the entire world change. We are here today because of a few guys 2,000 years ago that said, I am going to follow Christ on this amazing, thrilling ride, and it's going to change the world. And that they did. That's why we're here. And I want you to know, the same Holy Spirit that was in Jesus, the same Holy Spirit that was in the early disciples, is the same Holy Spirit that is available to you today. And we talked about this as a church back at the beginning of the year. We talked about this idea of pursuing the wind. That the wind is the Holy Spirit. And we said, let's pursue the wind. And it's crazy. We didn't know what it would do, but I remember saying this at the beginning of the year. We are going to pursue the wind. We are going to chase the wind this year. And as we chase the wind, I don't know what all God's going to do, but I'm confident he's going to do some crazy things. And after saying that, 3 months later, we started a campus in Ainer, South Carolina. Right? We had no plans of that as a church, but that happened because we were just chasing the wind. And now that church is going to be meeting for their first ever Christmas service tonight as a church, as a campus. We've seen God do great things and believe he's going to continue to do great things there. That as we chase the wind, this year we launched a coffee bar in Las Vegas, Nevada, all right? That's crazy. All right, let's just admit it. What in the world is a small church in Conway, South Carolina doing ministering in Las Vegas? I'll tell you what we're doing. We're chasing the wind because there's people there that matter to God. And we'll go to Las Vegas, we'll go to the Dominican Republic, we'll go to Haiti, we'll go to Africa, we'll go to Pennsylvania, we'll go wherever the Lord tells us if we're chasing the wind and simply doing what God tells us to do. And tonight, that church in Las Vegas is going to have their first ever Christmas experience in the C3 coffee bar, all right? So it's crazy. This year, we went on a thrill of hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. We changed a lot in our This Gen Ministries this year. We said the number one thing is making sure that every kid, every student, every young adult gets a coach in their life. And that has transformed our church. You see more and more teenagers and young adults and upper elementary kids serving and leading and doing ministry because they recognize the call of God in their life. That's worth celebrating right there. We've given as a church hundreds of thousands of dollars away this year through our missions department and through the coffee bar, just trying to love people. Because what we're doing is we're following the power of the Holy Spirit. We've changed some of the ways that we do things in here, where we've been kind of inviting the Holy Spirit, say, Holy Spirit, move, and move through the Word of God, and we're just letting the Word of God go out. And what has happened is it's changed our worship, but it's also changed lives. Do you realize, as of Thursday night, we've seen 290 people give their life to Christ through baptism. 290 people have taken the step of baptism, which means they're saying, Holy Spirit, I want you in my life, I want to live for you, and I want to go on this thrill ride. And that is available to each and every one of us. Christianity is not boring. I feel confident in saying this, that you can pick up the life that Jesus hopes for you. And when you do so, you'll experience the thrill of hope. And you'll experience the promise of hope, because he is the source of hope. So as we move into a time of response, let me kind of say it this way. That hope has a name. His name is Jesus. And he's waiting on you. And he's giving you a gift right now. And the gift is hope. It's hope. And unfortunately, what happens to too many of us is Christ gives us this gift of hope, which is really the gift of life. Life that we were expecting, life that we were hoping for, life on this side of heaven and on that side of heaven. Life here on this earthly place, but also life eternity. And he gives us this gift of life, this gift of hope. And too many times we take it and we're like, thanks. No, I got it. Oh, you want me to open it? See, just receiving this gift from God, that he came and he died on the cross and rose from the dead for us so that we could have life, so that we could have hope. That's one thing for us to say, oh yeah, I get it. But it's a whole nother thing to receive it. When you give a gift in the next couple days to your family member, your loved one, your kid, whatever, you don't want them just to take the package and hold it. You want to see them tear into it. You want to say, come on now, open that gift, tear away that tape, get rid of that wrapping paper, open that gift and actually receive it. And I think that's what Christ wants for you. Is he wants you to receive the life that he's offering. And that's what I want you to do as well, is to receive that life that he's offering. And the way that you will truly receive that life is by picking up what Christ has given you and go to him as the source. And let him come into your life. See, it's one thing for us to show up. It's another thing for us to hear it. But it's totally a different thing for us to respond to it. And to respond is for us to say, you know what? I'm willing to drop everything else and with confidence pick up the hope that he's offering me. And that hope is life. It's the life that you've been expecting. It's the life that you've been hoping for. So right now, during this time of response, I want to invite you to pick up that life. To receive that hope. And for some of you, you've never done this before in your life. And I'm going to invite you this morning to respond to Christ's gift of grace, his gift of life. I'm going to invite you to come forward today. We've got a bunch of these little tea candles just up across the front of the stage, over through the prayer corner. And maybe today what you need to do is you need to come up and you need to say, Christ, I'm coming to you as the source of hope because I want to experience life and life to the fullest. And I invite you just to take that little tea candle and light it off of one of the other tea candles. I'll let you know there's a bunch of fake candles up here. Don't try to light it off the fake candles. Fake candles will not give you power. They will not give you life. They will not light your candle. Just like other things in life that are fake will not light up your life. They won't give you the hope. They won't give you what you're looking for. But God can. Christ can because he's the source. So this morning, if you're ready to respond to Christ, maybe come up and light that candle. But that's not it. Light the candle. That's just for you to say, yes, I'm doing something. But then you need to go talk to somebody. We'll have prayer counselors over there in that prayer corner. We'll have prayer counselors at the Connect corner. We'll have prayer counselors over here by the baptistry corner. That I want you to go and talk to somebody. Others of us, though, what you need to do is this morning, you need to remember or you need to give thanks to God for the hope that he has given you, the life that he has given you. And I want you to feel free to come up and light a candle as well. Maybe take communion while you're doing that. So if you want to get baptized, you want to light a candle, you want to pray, you're ready to receive Christ, I want you to do that as we respond. Do me a favor. Let's stand up and let's pray. Jesus, I come before you right now, Father. And I ask that you move in our midst. God, I ask that you do something that I know you desire, that you want to move in our lives. You want to give us the life that we've been hoping for. In Christ, we know that it comes through you. In your name, amen. Let's spend some time responding.
All things have passed away. Your love has stayed the same. Your constant grace remains the cornerstone. Things that we you are the one.
pour